Everyone, good evening. Now, the Global Open Course Winter Olympic Games series has come to its eighth session for the 2021 Open Course series. And due to the pandemic control concerns, we have changed this course and we have moved this class online. From our short video, you probably know who will be the speaker today. Our alumni, Madam Yang Yang, winner of the World Winter Olympics, and also the Chinese chairman of the anti an anti-doping committee, and Madam Yang Yang has had a lot of experience with the Olympic Games and a lot of ups and downs through the Olympic Games. And let's hear her story tonight. Everyone, good evening. It's a regret that I can't be there to talk to you face to face, but it gives me great pleasure to be here. And then it's my honor to be here to talk to you online, to share with you my Winter Olympics experience. In the short video before this course started, you saw a snapshot of our efforts during our bid for the Beijing Winter Olympic Games. It is our dream to welcome athletes from all over the world to come to Beijing to realize their Olympic Games, just like I did in three cities in three countries. Okay. Now, I will share with you my Olympic Games experience. And I know that a lot of you, a lot of the students from Tsinghua University will volunteer during the Winter Olympic Games. And I want to thank you for your contribution, volunteer service. Not only offers assistance to others, but also will be a great experience in your growth. And I hope that we will see you all, the growth of all of you during those Winter Olympics. Now I'll kick off my presentation today. Before I introduce to you the before I start with my presentation for my own experience, let me tell you about the first Winter Olympics in the world. It was held in January 1924 in Chamonix, France. Then it was confirmed as the first Olympic Games after 4 years after the previous Olympic Games. Over 200 athletes, almost 300 athletes participated in four events. Now, let me share with you Chinese story with the Olympic Games. In 1980, we sent our first Olympic delegation to Lake Placid in America for the 13th Winter Olympics. The person who was holding the Chinese flag is called Zhao Weichang. He is in his 60s and 70s already. I interviewed him, I talked to him not long ago when he recalled his experience at that first Chinese Winter Olympics. He was still very excited. At that time, the winter sports was not very much popularized in China. Our goal or our dream then was to break the zero medal status or win our first gold medal. So why did Beijing bid for the Winter Olympics? I'm sure that you've all read a lot of reports. So the first reason is to manifest the image of China as a major country. We know that in 2008, we have already showcased the Chinese, China's image as a responsible major country, a country willing to share our development with the world and to show our hospitality, etc. So we've had a Summer Olympic in 2008, and this Winter Olympic will be another opportunity for us to show the world how open we are. So the image of China as a major country is not just a picture we want to present to the world, but actually the actual attitude we have towards the world as a responsible country, as a country that wants to share our winter, our sports spirit with the rest of the world. And we also want to, through this opportunity, uplift the spirit of the Chinese nation. And so that everyone will be greatly encouraged by these games, by the demonstration of the spirits of our Chinese nation. The third reason is more specific, which is to promote the coordinated development of Beijing, Tianjin, Hebei region through these games. Through last 6 years of preparation, you must have felt that Chongli in Hebei has experienced great changes. It used to be a very poverty-stricken county, but now it has already become a very popular winter resort. After this Olympic Games, I'm sure it will become an internationally renowned winter resort. So these games will promote not only the economic development of the Beijing, Tianjin, Hebei, but also enhance the cultural development there. A lot of you, some of you, may be coming from this area, and I believe that you, all of you, will be great spokespeople for our country during the games. The last reason why we want to host this Winter Olympics is that we want to bring new hopes to the Olympic Games. When we bid for the Games, we put forward the plan for the 2020. We want to, we laid down a lot of goals with regard to how to host a Games that is really sustainable, that show that also features a frugality, which will also really be appealing and attractive to young people. So during the bidding, some countries quit during the last stage. Only China and another country remained during the last round of bidding. We, as a responsible nation, stuck to what we started, even against, we know that since then, we have been made very serious preparation for these games, even despite the difficulties presented by the pandemic and the economic difficulties that the world has experienced together. And we believe that in the future, when we look back, we will be very proud of what we have endeavored to do. So when in our bid, we committed to host an athlete-centered Winter Olympics featuring sustainability and frugality with an inclusive, open, green, and clean approach. When talking about athlete-centered Olympic Games, actually, in 2006, we have we formed the organizing committee, and I was honored to be named as the chairperson for that committee and to contribute to the preparation of the Winter Olympic Games in Beijing. So I have served in the International Olympic Games for 8 years, and one of my obligations is to introduce or to share our experience with regard to the preparation for the Olympic Games. So we would often say that as long as those athletes are well served, then this game is 90% successful already. So athletes are the most important part of the games in terms of transportation, accommodation, catering. We have to satisfy every need of theirs. Another very important thing for the Olympic development is sustainability. I remember that many years ago when people talked about sustainability, people thought that idea was empty, it was just a slogan, an ideal. But actually in recent years, we have seen that sustainability featured very high in our development agenda. At the when we formed the Beijing Winter Olympics Committee, we had a dedicated office or a unit dedicated to the sustainability and the sustainable development of venues, talents, etc. And also the sustainable development of the whole winter sports, not just for these games, but also for the future. Yeah, we know that this Beijing Winter Olympic Games will be a great event, but we hope that in the future, the legacy of these games will also contribute more to the future development of sports, of the even the Chinese development of China in the future. Then frugality is also a strong feature of our Winter Olympic Games. It is a strong feature of our development strategy and also the direction in the future games. I'm honored that during my service on the International Olympic Games Committee, I am also on the new standards or new norms part of the games. So my job in that working team is to ensure the very good athlete experience despite the cut in budget. So during the Olympic Games, we very often have to prepare 24-hour catering services for our athletes. Of course, for some time period, we'll offer simplified food. And also, when it comes to the provision of towels, we have also made sustainable arrangements. So everything about sustainability can be felt in the details. So that's a very good experience for me. So after our successful bidding, we, of course, as I mentioned, we want to have an inclusive, open, green, and clean approach towards the games. I think this is very clear to all of you. I won't go into details. Another thing is that during our bidding efforts, during our preparation, we have the strong support, full support from our leadership at all levels. Since the successful bidding of the Winter Olympic Games, at the end of each year, the beginning of each year, our leaders of our country will pay an inspection visit to us to see how we are going on with our preparation, how athletes have been preparing for their games, etc. They would also sometimes go to see the training of our athletes to show them their support, to assure them of all the support that the country will offer to them. Since the outbreak of the pandemic, we are expected to hold a so-called simplified game, but yet not losing any of its charm. We want it still to be very exciting, even though that we have kept back on some of the preparations due to the pandemic control measures and requirements. So even though that only a limited number of audience will be on site, but we still hope that this will be a game for all. And we are confident that we can count on the support of the whole society. And we appreciate the understanding from all sides for the arrangement we have. So I'm going to now share with you my personal experience.
Let's take a look at the photos on my right-hand side, whether I think it's on your, can you see which one is me? Can you tell which one is me? This is a question leaving left for you. Please guess and provide your answer in the chat box. If you can guess correctly, you may get a prize. On the left-hand side, I'm sure you are all familiar with this, what this is. It's frozen. Ice and snow. It's very happy childhood. For me, in my childhood, I was very happy. I was very happy, equally happy as how the characters felt in Frozen. I was born in the Northwest, and winter is very long in the Northeast. Winter is very long in that part of China. And during winter months, we played very happily. I started to learn skating at the age of 9, and at 15, I got my first national champion. And at age 20, I got my first world champion, and I took part in 3 Winter Olympics. I took part in the first, in 1998, I took part in the Nagano Winter Olympics in Japan. That was my first experience in Winter Olympics. In the 300 meter relay race, I won the silver medal. In the 500 meter race, I was disqualified due to a foul. And this picture was taken when my mate came over to comfort me. So my career didn't start very successfully, but that wasn't important. In 1998, I got the silver medal of the 300 meter relay race. And then in the 1,000 meter semifinal, I was the first to have crossed the finishing line and broke the world record. But half a minute later, I was disqualified due to a foul. That was so difficult for me to accept, and I dared not. I was scared to think back because it was very difficult to prepare for the 1998 Winter Olympics, and I was ready to retire after the Winter Olympics, but things didn't turn out as I planned. It was okay for me to lose, but I wasn't prepared to lose because of a foul, even though that was controversial. So when I came back, I spent some time and I tried to think back. And I found that I need to face up to the music. Back then, I was quite sure I wanted to retire, and I decided to go to colleges and universities. And I found that because the speed skating was not very a popular item, not every college or university accepted athletes in this event. I was a world champion. I was not able to get accepted by a university back then. Another thing is when I was deciding to retire, I found that maybe it was because I couldn't face the failure and I couldn't settle down with the idea that I retired because of failure. So I couldn't retire on this situation. So I decided to stay. And then I attributed part of the failure to referees. And it was very clear that I needed to find the real cause to why the referee decided to make that ruling. I needed to find out whether it's possible to change what I could do, since I couldn't change the referee or the athletes. So back then, I actually looked back at the games, at what happened, at what I did. I went through the details and I tried to spot on details where I could improve. For example, when I turned the corner, I tried to improve on details so that I leave no reason for referees to make controversial ruling. So when I did that, I found that it was not as painful as I had imagined. I actually felt excited because I found that I could be stronger. So when I actually sat down and faced my failure, I really didn't feel that kind of failure that I thought I could feel. I got excited when I found room for improvement, because when you find room for improvement, you actually have the possibility to improve. So a month later, at the World Championship, with the same referees, the same opponents, I won. I got actually three gold medals, and I became world champions for three times consecutively. Actually, from 1997 to 2002, I didn't fail for once, and I was the overall world champion for 6 consecutive years. So in total, I got 59 world championships. What I want to say here is that 1998 was a failure to me, but I learned lessons from that failure. And I learned that when you lose something, you gain something. And the failure in 1998 actually gave me an opportunity to fly higher later. So I became world champion for 6 consecutive years. I was asked by a journalist, is it because you are better than others? When I was trying to answer the question, I got a flashback. A picture popped up in my mind. I don't think I was better than others because it's a fair playing ground. Everybody has their own training scheme and the information is symmetrical. Everybody is talented. So for me, more importantly, this picture popped up in my mind. I felt like I was always standing on the edge of a cliff. So I always have this sense of crisis. For example, even though I got world championship, I still reviewed the competition and I tried to learn lessons. Because usually I would feel happy for 2 days, and on the third day, I pretended to be, for example, a coach, a Korean coach, and looked at my competition and then decided how I could win the next race next time. And if I use his perspective, I can find some room for improvement. So I always tried to find my shortcomings and I tried to work to overcome those shortcomings. So it wasn't because I was better than others, it was because I identified my shortcomings, I also identified my strengths and I played out my strengths and overcame my shortcomings. That's why I became world champions for 6 consecutive years. And this sense of crisis was the reason. Also, I want to tell you this. You can see that speed skating is actually a sports event with a lot of accidents. Why are you so lucky? People usually ask this question. I don't think I am lucky. I am a professional athlete. I don't think my success is built on coincidence, because actually you can see that underneath the accidents or underneath the coincidence, there is something consistent, and you need to find that pattern. You need to find that rule of law of things. For example, even when you think that the referee has made a decision that is mistaken, you need to you need to check out all the details, and you need to understand the opponents or the fellow players in the same race. And I try to avoid accidents caused by fellow athletes, caused by fellow contenders, because I want to avoid accidents. So I always tread on thin ice. I tried my best to avoid accidents. So I don't think coincidence I think coincidence should be avoided, and you need to find the patterns and you need to make preparations for accidents to happen. You need to be cautious. You need to guard against accidents. And you need to make plan Bs. So this is the second point I want to make. So in speed skating, when you watch speed skating, when you see accidents, please observe, watch how good athletes behave, because they are usually prepared. They wouldn't be affected by such accidents. So that accident took place in 1998, and it was very hard to train and prepare for the winter for that games. I couldn't sleep and I got hurt, and I think career as an athlete, 1998 was the most difficult year. And I broke the world record for 1,000 meters. I didn't get the world championship even with that, even with breaking the world record. I was very fast, so I started to think beyond being fast, what else? I think you need to have strategy, you need to have tactics, you need to be prepared for accidents to happen, you need to make plan Bs. The national team was set up in 1995 with athletes from Heilongjiang and Jilin provinces, as well as the Bayi team. So it is a sports event for individual athletes. It is also a sports event for team playing, because there was relay. Back then, in 1998, we didn't work well as a team. But after 1998, I came to see that we needed to prepare for the next Winter Olympics, and for that we needed to have a real team. So I started to think about how to work with others as a team. Before that, there was actually frictions between individual athletes. So with this awareness, I started to talk to other athletes. I started to see support for other athletes, mutual support.
So we didn't make any breakthrough in terms of number of gold medals. So we all started to think about what we needed to do. We need to build trust. We needed to support each other. Then for 4 years consecutive later, we got gold medals for relay races. And we individually, we've also pocketed a lot of medals. And later, in another world champion, we got 10 gold medals out of 12 altogether. It was a proud moment. It was a time of great feeling and a great sense of unity. So we helped each other to grow. When we build a team, we need to think about, we need to think in each other's shoes, which is very important. Empathy is very important. In my work today, as still, it is very important because only by doing that, can you get more support? Of course, you have to offer support to others as well. That will ensure the success of your work. So coming to 2002 Winter Olympics in Salt Lake City, it was an experience from heaven to hell. I have been in a very good state before the Olympic Games. And I was training with four male athletes from our youth team. So for the 1,000-meter race, I could really outrun them, those young male athletes. But the thing is that in the 1500 meter, I was surpassed by a very young Korean athlete. Because it's a kind of a normal maneuver by that athlete, but I was having a lot of expectations for this game. During the semifinal, I took lead from a very early stage, and my strength was not enough to sustain me towards the end of the race. So I was really hungry for the result. I didn't summarize the reasons or analyze the reasons for my failure for that in a timely manner. So during the 20 minutes between the semifinal and the final, I had already lost my confidence for the final. I approached Yang Yang S, because he would also, I said that I would cooperate, you know, to support you. I hope that that will help you to win. And so I didn't aim for the gold medals, but Yang Yang S actually said that, no, I want to support you. I want to cooperate with you. So Yang Yang S was asked during an interview, said, why didn't you accept that assistance from Yang Yang A? Because then she said that, I don't think that's an opportunity. I think it's really a big pressure. It's very stressful. So the stress, the pressure from the big games is really on a very different scale from other games. And we have really been looking forward a gold medal and the Olympic game. Gold medal from the 1978. So a lot of expectations from the media, from ourselves, and we felt that we couldn't face our nation, our people, if we lost. So I did lose. I did fail to achieve the gold medal. I tried to avoid everybody, even during the meals. So for me, everything looked great, like hell. So I was very I was terrified of all succeeding games. So when I recalled those days, my team members had tried to encourage me. Then I remembered that Yang S came to my room and to check me up. And later I found out that she was sent by our coach to see how I was doing. So our coaches, our delegation leaders all tried to talk to me and talk me out of the gloom. And then before the final games, I remember that the head of the Chinese delegation, Tim Yeomin, we had a group discussion, and he actually asked the four other team members to analyze, to make analysis for me. And I actually had a kind of emotional uproar inside me. And just, you know, I felt that why should I take all the stress? Why should I be the one to get the gold medal? So, but then what my team member said really got to me, really touched me. And for example, Yang Yang S said that before the semifinal, I saw that Yang Yang A needed an uplift, but I didn't remind her. I told myself that you just have to be make sure that you are at the best state. So she felt that it was her mistake not to have reminded me. And I actually was very touched by that, because we all felt very much the same, right? We wanted ourselves to be the best, and we didn't look out really for our team members. So I really was determined then to make sure that I will pocket a gold medal then. So I think that the strength from inside was very important. So after that meeting, when I came back to my room, I did all the necessary things to prepare for the games. You know, I cut my own hair, I cut my fingernails, you know, all of these really just to try to calm me down, all of these little details, and maybe a little bit of superstition. So it's like a little ritual, which is very important for the state of mind for an athlete, but these rituals really didn't work as usual. I was still not completely out of the gloom from the failure from the semifinal. But then I tried my best, and I just told myself, you know, you are at the bottom, and then all you can do from now on is to go upwards. Because I clearly remember that during the 1500 final that Yang Yang S fell, and she couldn't keep up with the match anymore. But I was in a good station. But then because of my lack of confidence, I basically just give myself up. And then if this kind of emotion still remains, then it will be really difficult for me to go on with other games. I just have to tell myself that nobody else would fall. I have to make myself believe that. So I was very hard with myself. I was very hard with the results of mine. I was in a very stressful state because I was really hard with the results of mine. But then I realized that I can't be hard. Well, I can't compete with the results. Everything I could do is to make sure that I skate each lap the best way I could. I just have to be focused on the next lap. So in order to remind myself again for the next games, I write down some of the rules. How should I start? After the start, how do I move my arms? How do I move my legs? I just focus on the details. I just focus on what to do next instead of focusing on the results. So details really determine the results. Now I'm going to play a short video and I will share with you, I will try to explain to you some of the details that I talked about. So at that time, there was an American athlete in the third track. And she was asked how she felt about competing with the two top athletes in the world. Is it a dream realized? She said, it's not a dream, it's a nightmare. So you can see the athlete next to me is from Russia. She's the record keeper. But even though she's a world record keeper, but there is a little bit distance between us. When I was leading, I realized that she was behind me. I know that if I slow down, she would very well likely surpass me. So I kept that speed.
And there will be Jamilia from the Chinese supporters here in the Salt Lake Ice Center. But you can see Yang Yang A overcome with emotion. She's won the world championship every year the past 5 years. She's been the pitch of consistency she's never won.
Okay. So I'll pause here. So let me explain to you some of the details. As I mentioned, the Russian skater behind me was a very strong competitor. She was right behind me. So I knew that I had to make sure that I left no opportunity for her to surpass me. I felt that at one point, there was a very tiniest amount of pause at one point. I was trying to block her. I intervened with her rhythm. I blocked her twice, actually, which really interfered with her rhythm. So after this game, I really realized that I felt the strength of details. So after the 1998 failure to 2002, during these 4 years, I made a lot of preparations. I thought, in 1998, I thought if I lost again in 2002, could I accept that reality? So I have to, you know, set me up a big picture. I didn't want to be uncertain about what I wanted to do for the next 4 years. So at that time, I decided that the only way I could accept a failure is that I really tried, but I still couldn't make it. But if I have tried, then I'll have no regret. That's what sustained me for the next 4 years of hard work. So the realization of dream is really not about how much talent you have, but is really about how much courage you have to face failure and to face the future. So responsibility is also very important. So before the 2002 games, I was the strongest athlete on our team and who had the biggest chance or highest odds of winning a gold medal. I knew that, but I really got encouraged by my team members when they tried to help me to analyze my games to you know, and then I really strongly felt a sense of responsibility, and that has also been a very important factor that has kept me going. The responsibility can be stress, but it is also a strong force of motivation. So after the 2002 games, I applied for the Tsinghua University. It was not easy. I thought that, oh, now it was an Olympic Games. You know, it was the first Winter Olympic Game gold winner. I think Tsinghua would readily accept me. So I applied for the university, but I didn't get the notice for an interview until the end of August.
I asked several times for the results, and I was told that they were still considering my application. I remember at the interview, I remember it's a Professor Yang. He told me that Tsinghua University welcomes world champions. But they hope that they expect world champions to be really studying there. I treasure my 4 years at Tsinghua University. And then 4 years later, I went to Utah University for exchange. Then I left the national team and I started living in the US as an individual without attachment to the national team. And I was living on my own in a foreign country. It's a totally different experience. I've missed the warmth of the team, the warmth that the team afforded me when I was living alone in the US. I remember in the US, I was watching a competition. Chinese athletes were not doing very well, and I was very worried that we have lost our advantage. And then I was asked whether or not I could go back to the national team. I decided to go for two reasons. One, I felt happy because I was needed. Two, I think it is a good opportunity for me to play my role in whether getting the gold medal or in supporting young athletes. So I actually suspended my studies in Tsinghua University and took part in the Winter Olympics in Turin, Italy in 2006. I was honored to be the flag bearer of our delegation. I got a bronze medal at that game, at that games. That was a very important experience for me, even though it was not a gold medal. That was actually very good retirement for me. I left the rink with a sense of contentment. Now I'm going to tell you a few stories. The reason why I'm telling this story is that they actually have changed me a lot. Story one, here you can see the marching of the American delegation at the Salt Lake City Winter Olympics. The flag bearer came to me the night before and told me that she would be the flag bearer. It is an honor for anybody to become a flag bearer. And many countries would choose world champions to bear the flag. But this girl, Amy, she, in comparison with other professional athletes, didn't do well. There were a lot of stars in the national delegation. I was surprised why she was chosen to be the flag bearer. I asked the head of the delegation, and I was told that of all the American athletes, Amy is the only one who's been to 5 Winter Olympics, Olympic Games. That means she has to stay on her best for 16 years at least. And that's rare achievement. So before 2006, I was aiming for gold medals. We only aimed to get Winter Olympics, and my fellow athletes, they also wanted to get gold medals. But then with this story, with Amy's story, I realized actually being persistent is acknowledged to be an achievement. In sports, everybody is saying that you need to retire when at your best. But this story told me you need to be persistent. You need to carry on the legacy. Maybe you are not understood by others, but I actually think it is necessary to persist. That was why I decided to go back. Now, the second story, this is a picture taken at the Turin Winter Olympics. This story took place in the 20 kilometer relay, women's skiing. Then the Canadian team was leading, and the athlete with the second baton had an accident and fell from number 2 to number 4. Canada, when this accident took place, they were actually not close to their coach. Just at the moment, the coach of the Norway team handed them the gear they needed. And Canada team, with that support, went up to number 2 again, and they got the medal in the end. So this story is very special for me, because then when the Canadian team was number 4, the third team, the number 3, the team at the third position was Norway team. And Norway coach actually handed the gear to their opponent, to their competitor. This is very strange. This is very strange. And the coach was interviewed by many people. He said, as a coach, I don't want to see athletes failing because of failure of gear. This story was very influential, and the Canada team got their title, and the Canadians became very interested in Norway. They have millions of questions about Norway. They wanted to know why this coach was so great. And the Canadians did a lot to repay the kindness and support afforded by the Norwegian coach. I still feel thrilled when I am telling the story. Now I'm going to tell you 2 more stories. I'm not going to actually tell in language, but I'd like to tell the story with clips of video.
Slovenia,
She's from Slovenia. When she was warming up, she felt and her ribs broke, but he actually persisted through the preliminary competition, and he actually was qualified for the final. And he got a bronze medal. She got a bronze medal. So I always think if everybody is so determined, nothing can defeat us. So you have to trust yourself. Next story. This is a marathon athlete from Tanzania. So we know that there is a time limit. He was wounded, but he didn't quit the marathon. According to reports, the venue was closed, but a journalist found somebody was still running, and the journalist told the organizing committee, so the venue was opened to welcome this marathon runner. He said, "My country sent me here from 5,000 miles away, not for me to win the competition, but for me to finish the race." So every time I see him, I feel excited. Okay, this is another piece of video which I shot at the stadium in Tsinghua University. In this video, I am trying to send a message to all the athletes coming to the Winter Olympics to be held in Beijing. So what I want to say here is the Winter Olympics is coming. I hope through stories you get to know more about athletes when you watch the competition. Please cheer for them. To end my lecture, I want to say we need to keep dreaming because dream enables you to see the future. Let's go and watch the Winter Olympic Games, cheer for athletes from all over the world and cheer for ourselves. Thank you for your sharing. I now understand